She's so curious about the tablet. She's like, what is it? Is it edible? Can I have a bite? Hi. Can I help you? Hey y'all, it's Natalie, Knits with Horses, and I'm gonna take a shot at doing episode 3. I'm in a different setup today, which you can probably tell. I'm having to work a lot in my RV. This RV is old, it's an 85. And it's got some things in it that we're needing to fix up, and I've got a lot of work to do in here, so I just really, I'm kind of fitting this in my rest, my breaks on working out here, so, we'll make it work. Let's see, what have I been doing this week? Well, this has been a rough week for me. A really, really dear friend of mine, in Philadelphia passed away. Been dealing with that, and then with the RV and all that, and it's just been kind of not a great week, but in some ways it is great, and that's what we're gonna focus on. So the love of my life segment today, I think what I'm gonna do is kind of combine my health accountability, the love of my life, and a little demonstration of something that I'm knitting right now, because when I did the little video demonstrating the technique, I got talking about why I knit continental and my health and all that, and I think I'm gonna and combine those at the end and put the love of my life on that part too. As for the knitting with horses this week, there hasn't been any. We did go out to the horses, but I've been running in 6 directions and did not have time to just stay out there and knit, and it's killing me. I'm really hoping that probably today is Thursday. And Monday or Tuesday, I'll be going down, and I probably will hang out there a good half a day. And what I do out there is the horses, when we drive up into the pasture, our horse and all the other horses just kind of surround the pickup, you know, and come stick their heads in and say hi and want attention and treats. And I mess with the horse for a while, and then I usually will either sit, depending on the weather and my mood, I'll either sit in my pickup, or there's picnic tables out there, I might sit at a picnic table, or just in the back of the truck, whatever I feel like doing, and I knit, because I feel at peace there, or with the horses around me. I've always been more comfortable in nature, and when horses are around, I'm in heaven. So, I'm not a city person, I'm not a town person at all. So if I can be out there, 200 acres, trees, horses, you know, some sunshine and the breeze, soak up my D3 from the sunshine, you know, I'm good. But I literally knit out there with the horses, so I have not been able to do that this week, and that may be contributing to my less than chipper mood. But and that's also why I sit in my pickup a lot when I'm at home. I've always been someone who would rather be outside than inside. And when I was, that's a big part of why when I was crippled for all those years, I fell into such a deep depression. Another subject. Anyhow. So, dealing with all the stuff this week, and all the things, and knitting, as usual, has helped keep me sane. So what's the next? I don't have my notes with me. I thought I could do it without notes. It's just silly. I don't even really follow the notes very well when I do have them. But let's see, what was next? What's the next? Oh, fangirl, my fangirl moment. Well, that's easy this week because in my first two videos, Turbo Knitter commented on my videos. And in the second one, he even actually let me know that he would like to send me one of his knitting bags. If you watch his videos, you've seen the knitting bags that he makes, and they're so cute. And I've never had a knitting bag. I feel like, should I have not been saying that? You know, did it sound like I was like, poor me, I don't have a knitting bag? But, I mean, I hope that I'll be able to have lots of those because they really are cute and functional, and I cannot tell you how excited I am that he's going to send me one of his knitting bags. And I haven't gotten puffy mail in so long because I've been on such a strict yarn diet, and I can't do, I haven't been able to shop for books online. I haven't been able to shop for knitting stuff online. Anything that I haven't gotten any puffy mail of any kind in a really long time. So this is exciting for me. And also just because Turbo Knitter's one of the first ones that I started watching. I really like his podcast. My friend Paula sent me a list of podcasters. She told me about podcasts, and I was like, I don't, what? Knitting podcasts? I thought there was not, she was talking about the kind that you listen to on iTunes, which just don't do it for me. Knitting is visual. And I do listen to audio podcasts on other subjects, like on nutrition and things like that, but I couldn't see the point of listening to a knitting podcast. I tried it a couple times and wasn't interested. She said, no, they're on YouTube, and you watch them. And she sent me a list of her favorites, and I mean, it was a pretty long list, so I just picked a few and started watching them. And then, you know, gradually, as they would mention somebody or one would pop up in the recommended for you because I'd watched that one, you know, then I added. And she was like, this is just a few that'll get you started down that rabbit hole. And boy, was she not kidding. Anyway, Turbo Knitter was on that list. And I just really, really enjoy his podcast. I enjoy his laid-back style. I really enjoy the ones that it's almost like they just invite you into their, and I hope this is kind of like how I am too. They just sort of invite you into their living room to sit down and chat with them about knitting, you know? And I like that he mentions sometimes the charity knitting that he does. And I have a soft spot for guys that knit. I taught my son to knit when he was, a teenager. I didn't teach him the whole range, but he wanted to get in on knitting. I was doing a big charity project with a whole bunch of little newborn hats. They were trying to get so many, you know, I don't remember the details, but I was making hat after hat, these little newborn hats to go overseas. And when I told him what it was for, he was just like, I want to do that. I want to help. And this is a teenage boy, you know. Well, he was probably 18, 19. He was working on those when he met his wife, and he's 30. So he was probably 19 or 20. And I kind of do have a soft spot for the guys that knit. So if you haven't checked out Turbo Knitter, you definitely have to check out Turbo Knitter. He's got quite a few videos. He's had some health problems recently and hasn't been putting them out real fast, and I'm anxious for the next one. But I think you'll really enjoy him. So that's my fangirl moment. And I think we go from there into whips, right? Whatever. Today we're going from there into whips. And my whips, I'm mostly just still working on my, I'm still working on my Cozy Memories blankets. But I also started, where is it? Sorry, excuse me. New setup. Okay. I started three new projects that I want to show you. I have not worked on the socks, and those are still on my mind every day. I'm thinking about it and thinking I really want to do that, and I haven't done it yet. And my son's hoodie, I haven't gotten back to work on that yet. But All the people working on shawls have got given me shawl fever, and I have only knit one shawl in my life. It was a long time ago. It was made from lace weight. It was lacy, and I don't know how I got through it, but I did. But now, even though I've done that one, that it's been a while, I'm still really intimidated by shawls. So I thought I'll pick one that's nice and easy, and maybe even in a, it'll have to be in a worsted weight because I don't have any lace weight in my stash right now, and I am, as you know, stash busting. So I don't know if I'm going to keep this one or if it'll go to the reservation, to Pine Ridge Reservation. I do like to make, I have made, now I say I haven't made shawls, I've made rectangle shawls and lap robes and things like that out the yin yang. How funny, I said out the yin yang. This pattern is called the yin yang shawl, and it's from Patton's, and it's in worsted weight, so it goes pretty darn fast. And I'm making it, the reason I might keep this one is because I actually got this particular yarn to make myself some Broncos gear, because as we all know, I am a Broncos fanatic. And did you see that game Sunday? Okay, that's all right. We won't go into that. Anyhow, I love my Broncos. So, with no further ado, this is the beginnings of my yin yang Go Broncos shawl. I'm just trying to really get it in my head how shawls are actually constructed. And, you know, if you wanted the different shapes, how you would go about that and whatnot. So, I've been working on this a lot. I think at heart, I'm almost a monogamous knitter, because I almost just, like, if I sit down, I think, well, I'll rotate. I'll do this one. I'll work on this one for a little while, and then that one, and then that one, so that everything will progress a little bit, and I'll have something to show on my podcast. But I sit down and start working on this, and I'm watching TV or whatever, and this ain't ever going to get put down. I'm just going to work on this. And it went really fast at the beginning, which was really cool. Then you want to keep, you know, oh, wow, this is really going fast. But now it's to the point where I can do a couple of rows and put it down, because the rows are a lot longer. And so, you know, it's not as exciting. So, okay. So I did actually go ahead and start another pattern. I wanted to do something for the Geeky Girls autumnal color work knit along. I love color work and I love autumn, so I'm like, there's what I really, really need to do is get back to knitting Christmas stockings for my grandkids. I'll talk more about that in a little bit, but that's what I really, really need to be doing. But I fall is my season. I love fall. I love that color palette. I love the weather. I love everything about fall. And I really love color work, and I haven't done much of it lately. So, this is a project that won't take too terribly long, and I'm still deciding whether or not I'm going to do any of the bibs right now or wait until after I get some other things. I don't know. I want to do some of the double knit bibs that I was designing, but we'll see. What I might do is like use that as in between work, like, you know, make this much progress on Riley's stocking, and then I can do a bib or something. I don't know. That's yet to be decided. But I did want to do this for the autumnal. It's a cowl. It's from Creative Knitting Magazine. I can't show a whole lot because it's in a magazine. That just wouldn't be nice. But it's stranded knitting, and it's a special technique of stranded knitting that I actually did a video demonstrating how to do this. This pattern uses that technique, but that's a generally known and used technique. It's not, you know, they don't even really do a very good job of explaining it in this pattern, to tell you the truth. But so I did a little video showing, not with this, because that I feel like that would be showing too much of the pattern. But like I mentioned before, I got to talking about my health during while I was doing that demo, which is kind of weird how that all fit together. But so I'll put that demo towards the end of the video. But anyway, this is my what's it called? Twisted Floats Cowl from Creative Knitting, the one that's out on stands right now. And it there's more than one color pattern as you go along. This is the button band, and it's gonna go around my neck like always. And my daughter saw this and said, that's just really, that might be pretty if it was in better colors, but that's just some really ugly colors. I'm like, well, thank you very much. I like these colors. I like the fall. This is showing orange things with my shirt today. I should have stuck with my usual gray. I wear a lot of neutrals, but when I'm not wearing neutrals, a lot of times it's orange. So anyway, let's see if we can get the camera to focus on this instead of my orange shirt and hat. Yeah, I apologize about the hat too. Like I said, I'm working on my RV, and so I'm in work gear. Anyway, it's a nice little color. That's the front and that's the back. It's almost reversible. When you change what you're doing on the color work on the front, then it looks different on the back too. But with twined knitting, your back looks nice. Looks nice and organized and neat. So it's just a little cowl. It's going to button up. And I will show you a picture. I'm not going to try to do it right now because I'll end up showing part of the instructions, but I will show you a picture of the project. And I'm just making this out of Karen Simply Soft orange and brown, and that's that. And the other project that I've started, I have quite a bit of soft pink. I don't remember why I bought this, but I bought it years ago. It's in my stash, and I've got several balls of light pink. I don't do pink except for my granddaughter once in a while, and now she doesn't even like pink. She likes light teal and lavender. Can you say Elsa? Frozen? Yeah, that's Riley. So, I am using this. It's Hobby Lobby's I Love This Cotton in light pink. Let me get out of the way and see if it'll focus. I'm basically just doing, thank you camera for doing that right when I'm trying to, I'm just doing little washcloths, and then I will go, there's a store here that I can go and get little soaps that smell, there we go, soaps that smell nice, and I wrap them in plastic and put each one with a little washcloth, and those go with my stuff to the domestic violence center. And when I can find good deals on them, like the little travel pack sizes with toothbrushes and toothpaste and lotion, anything like that that I find on a good deal, I'll get them and put them in there. Because a lot of those ladies get to the domestic violence center with nothing but the clothes on their back. So any of that kind of thing, the domestic violence centers or one that's near you. I send them to the Pine Ridge Reservation, but if there's a domestic violence center in your community, support it. Just support it. So that is my WIPs other than my, oh no, I do have one other one. I didn't do my FOs because I don't have my FOs with me. My only FO was Nalu Mitts, which I gave to my granddaughter, and because I made them because she asked me for them. I made the other pair that was, I think I already showed as a finished object in an earlier video, and hello, come out of there. There's not much to show. I started another pair of mitts. I'm in a mitt along. There we go. With, I always get their name, Stitches and More podcast group. There we go. And this is going to be a different, I'll have to put the name of the pattern because I don't have it handy in my head right at the moment. I really don't. I'll have to put it on the screen what the next mitt I'm doing. I almost was going to just do another Nalu because I just love that pattern, but I thought, well, you know, just doing the same pattern over and over when this was a knit along where they kind of asked you to challenge yourself and not do anything real simple. And I love the Nalus. I really recommend them, but I think, what was this called? Oh, gosh, I can't remember. Anyway, this is still on the needles, but I have not made much progress. That's my DK weight Cozy Memories. Have not made any progress on the sock yarn one because I just don't have hardly any sock yarn. And here's my worsted weight one. I think I've put on a couple of squares. Wow. Hello. There we go. Yeah, big rent. I think I've added... I'll have to look back. I don't remember. I think I've added maybe three squares, 2.5 squares of this. This is my worsted weight Cozy Memories. I really like doing a worsted weight one of these, y'all. I think I will probably do those more often. Now, as for future plans, I kind of alluded to it. I have a project where I've been making Christmas stockings. This is all Christmas stockings. I wanted to make one for each member of my family, and I wish I had started with the little kids. I started with my own kids, who are grown-ups. My kids go from 20 to 35. I have 9 grandkids. I'm like, wait, no, 7 grandkids. I say 9 because my daughter's, my middle daughter, has a boyfriend with 2 little girls that I feel like I want to make them one too. That makes 9. But my oldest daughter has 5 boys, and then Cheyenne has Riley and Sawyer that I've been living with. I don't have stockings for the little kids, and I don't want to give any of them any of the stockings out, other than I can give Cameron and Stephanie theirs. I will give Cameron and Stephanie theirs. My son, my son's a truck driver, so that'll make his stocking make sense. This is my son's stocking, and I just designed it. This is not a pattern on anywhere. There's the truck. There's one on the back, too. And then the foot. But they don't have any children yet, so I've made Cameron's. And Stephanie is a very girly girl, and she likes purple. And so I made hers. This yarn has some mohair in it, so it's very fluffy. And it's got bobbles and cables. Again, no pattern. Just bobbles and cables. Camera, come on, camera. There you go. There's the color. And then the foot of the stocking. So that's theirs. I can give them theirs. But I can't give Bonnie and Jerome their stockings and not have the stockings for the boys. And I can't give Cheyenne her stocking when I don't have Riley and Sawyer's. I don't know if I will go ahead and give Cheyenne and Riley and Sawyer their stocking if I don't get one made for her boyfriend Sam and his 2 little girls. Because, now his 2 little girls will definitely be getting some socks for Christmas. I don't remember if I've mentioned it in a previous video, but these little girls are 7 and 9. The same age as my Cheyenne's kids. And I don't guess they have anybody in their life that knits because they're just fascinated by my knitting. And they ask me for socks. Could you make me some socks? I want some socks, you know. Beautiful little blonde-haired girls ask you to make them some socks. You're going to make them some socks. But I don't. What I don't know is if I get the grandkids' stockings made, will I give Cheyenne and Riley and Sawyer their stockings if I don't have one made for Sam and Cameron and Kylie? Yes. Cheyenne's boyfriend's little girl has the same name as my son, Cameron. Nothing confusing about that. So, Cameron and Kylie and Sam and Cheyenne, I know their relationship is such that they will be doing a lot of Christmas together. They're together a lot. And but they won't, I mean, Sam and the girls will have their Christmas things in their house, and Cheyenne will have their Christmas things in their house. So, but the girls come over several times a week. They like to come over in the morning before school and go ride to school. Cheyenne works at the school, and so they like to ride to school with Cheyenne and Riley and Sawyer. And then Cheyenne and Riley and Sawyer are usually at Sam's house over the weekend, so you know it'll be in their face, kind of. So I don't know, what would you do? Would you give Riley and Sawyer and Cheyenne their stockings if you aren't able to get one made? I'm just being realistic here. That's 10 stockings. Stockings. I don't do simple stockings. This is my youngest daughter Harmony's stocking. Harmony is all about two things, horses and books. So, she writes books and she reads incessantly. So, this is one that I designed. I did make some by pattern, a lot of them I designed. But, now, this foot came from a pattern that I followed, which is in here somewhere. This one too, see, same foot, different weight of yarn. And I don't remember right off the top of my head what the pattern was. I apologize. And I didn't mean to take all day showing each and every stocking, but I have one made for, this is for Jerome, my son-in-law. I don't have one made for Bonnie, my oldest daughter. I think I made this one for my husband. This is for my second to the youngest daughter, Virginia, who's all about music. I even put her name on this one. This is Jenny. See? Jenny. And then the music and the hearts. Jenny's my lovey. I like that. So I have Harmony. I have all the kids except for Bonnie. Did I not make one for Bonnie? Oh wait, I did too. Where is it? Here it is. Here's Bonnie's. I do have Bonnie's. So I have all of my kids and the son-in-law and the daughter-in-law. So this is Bonnie's. She's the one that I made that pillow for in similar colors that I have to make a new back for, if you'll recall, because she likes these colors, can you tell? So there's Bonnie, Harmony, Jenny, Jerome, Robert, my husband. And then Cheyenne, here's Cheyenne's. Cheyenne likes green. This one's cabled, and it's this stuff, I don't remember what this yarn is, but oh my gosh, it's soft. I wish I remembered what it was. Put hair on there. Anyway, that's Cheyenne's. And that's mine. So the grown-ups are all made, and also a Santa hat. I just need to make at least 7, preferably 9, children's stockings, and one for Sam. That's what I really need to be doing. That's my future plans. I'll be knee-deep in stockings from now until it gets really close to Christmas. Sorry, there is a bee who has decided to join me, a big bee, who has decided to join me in the RV. I'd rather not get to know him too well. So if you'll pardon me, I'm going to go let him out. Well, that was fun. So, I told you my only whip. Well, it wasn't really my only whip. This is a whip, because this is one completed washcloth, but it's the beginning of a project where I make a lot of washcloths. So there will be lots more little pink washcloths finished in the coming weeks. Is there anything I'm forgetting? I don't think so. I think that's it. So, that's the most of the knitting content, like I said, in my health and weight loss accountability section is actually going to also be a demo of the twined color work. Let's see what else. I'm listening. The book I'm listening to right now is Outlander, because my son and daughter-in-law and second to youngest daughter Jenny have been after me to watch the series Outlander. It's on Stars, I guess. And I had read those books. I read the first three or four books when they were first coming out, when you had to read one and wait until she finished writing the other one and then read it, you know. And I know the first three, maybe the first four. And I had actually told Cameron and Stephanie about them, and they listen to a lot of audiobooks too, because being a truck driver, they can listen to these books going down the road. And so they got an Audible account too. So, but my son's always saying, oh, this is the guy they got to play so-and-so. Do you think that works or whatever? He sends me these messages and I'm like, I can barely remember what I read last month. Fiction wise, nonfiction sticks with me better. But, fiction is just my entertainment for that moment and then I move on. And so I'm like, some books I can really remember and they stick with you, and then some are just the entertainment of the moment and you move on and you don't remember them several years later. But they just have been after me so much, so I finally went ahead and started listening to the Audible versions of Outlander. And the narrator on those is Davina Porter. And she does a great job. She really does. I mean, clearly she has to be this female voice of with the modern day Scottish accent, and then a very heavy Gaelic accent, and then there's the British dragoons, and she has to speak for women and men, and she just does a fantastic job. She's a great narrator. I'm only about halfway through book one, so these books are unabridged, and each book is like 30 something hours. So I'll be on Outlander for a while, and I don't know how long. I'll probably listen to Outlander for a while and then have to do something else. I just do nothing but Outlander for weeks on end is probably not going to happen. But, as I mentioned, my friend Bill had died and asked me to take over his health and nutrition group. And so I'm kind of going back and listening to the audio version of some of the books that are the gold standard in the whole food plant-based community for health and nutrition. So I've been kind of going back and listening to some of them. I'm listening to, and some of them you don't come on Audible and versions, and so I have to just read them. But I'm actually reading the actual book of The Pleasure Trap, and I'm listening to The China Study by T. Colin Campbell, and if that's of any interest to you, the notion that the food that modern people are eating is contributing to our decline in health and to dying younger, then absolutely read or listen to the China study. But anyway, so that's what I'm reading. I did so enjoy listening to Dodger again. That's one that I'll listen to over and over. It's such a good book. You guys should read Dodger. Terry Pratchett, Dodger. Read that one. What I'm watching, it's fall. All the new shows are coming on. The Voice is back. I love The Voice. Love, love, love The Voice. See, I did need my notes because I had made note of who really stood out to me so far in the auditions. The new coaches are Miley Cyrus and Alicia Keys, both very accomplished young ladies. I had my doubts about Miley. She's made some questionable choices in her adult life, but I honestly think a lot of that was just her taking a stand to say, I'm not Hannah Montana anymore, right? And I'm not Billy Ray's little girl. I am my own person, my own artist, and, you know. But she, I think she's doing a good job on there. She's pretty fun. Pretty fun. And seems to, and I mean, she knows the music industry. That's for darn sure. But Blake's my boy. I still love Blake. Alicia's kind of killing it. A lot of these people are just awestruck by Alicia Keys. And when she goes to pitch herself, she knows how to reach a person and connect with a person. So she's getting a lot of good artists. You're going to want to watch out for her. So anyway, The Voice. Yeah. And the new shows that are out, I have found two. This is pretty unusual. I usually don't give a rat's tail about the new shows that they bring out on network TV anymore. I mean, how many police procedurals does the world really need? And then those shows will go forever and ever and ever and ever. But Firefly gets canceled after two seasons. Dollhouse, canceled. Don't get me started. So while I do, there are certain police procedurals that I enjoyed or watched for a while. I just, golly, people. Enough. But I did find, so far, two of the new shows this season that I'm really liking. One is called The Story of Us. It's This Is Us. This Is Us. And it's a basically an hour-long drama, and not an hour for me because I record it so that I don't have to watch the commercials, but anyway, they take three different people all born on the same day, and they're kind of following their lives. It's just a really well done show. Good actors, good writing. I'm really enjoying it. The other show that I'm really, really loving, and I'll be brief, I'll just say Designated Survivor, Kiefer Sutherland, an attack on Washington kills everybody except for the designated survivor, and he's the secretary of HUD and housing or something like that, and ends up being thrust into the role of President of the United States. Fantastic concept. Really kind of takes you back at times to what it felt like at 9/11 and all that, but it's just, that's a show to watch, y'all. It's a good one. And other than that, I'm still watching Gilmore Girls, and my little granddaughter has got me started watching Heartland from the beginning again so that she can watch it. That's about it. I don't watch lots and lots of TV. Watch lots and lots of podcasts. So, anyway, I think that's probably going to about wrap it up. And then, like I said, I'll have the video of the demo video, in which I will also talk about a little bit about health and my health journey. And there will be some pictures, of course, of the horses at the end, as usual. Other than that, happy knitting, y'all, and I'll talk to you later. Okay, so this segment is going to be three different things combined. It's going to be the Love of My Life segment. It's going to be my health and accountability segment, and a demo of a technique that I'm enjoying right now. I'm not using the actual project that I'm making from the magazine, because that wouldn't be cool. But this is a universal technique, so there's lots of videos on YouTube if you want to find somebody that's better at doing how-to videos to show you actually how to do this. It's called twined knitting, and you can see on the front, it's just basically, you know, knit one of color A, knit one of color B, color A, color B, color A, color B. And on the other side, you purl one of color A, color B, color A, color B. But because of this twined technique, this is what the wrong side looks like, and I actually really love it. I kind of like it better than the right side, but I just decided, for purposes of this demonstration, I'd go ahead and make another one of my washcloths for the Domestic Violence Center, and just put a little garstitch border around the edge, and actually have an FO by the time I'm done. But when I started doing this and looking at the way this worked and starting on that autumnal cowl and everything, I realized that doing this technique, I really have to switch to using my right hand. I'm sure there's a good way to do it continental, where you hold the yarns in your other hand, or one in one hand and one in the other hand, and can make them twine like this. But I haven't been able to make that work for me, so I'm back to knitting English, which is what got me thinking about my mama and learning how to knit when I was a kid, and switching over to continental as an adult and all that kind of stuff, which is how I'm tying in the love of my life, which in this case is my mama, who may she rest in peace. My mama's been dead a number of years, and I still miss her every single day of the world. But she taught me how to knit English, although I didn't know it was called English. In our part of the world, you did picking or throwing. You know, were you a picker or a thrower? And mom was a thrower. But she did that kind where they have it on their finger and they barely move. They don't let go of the knitting needle, and they just kind of like that. And they can be really fast and accurate, and mom was all those things. I never could, even though I learned from someone who did at a very young age. I learned to crochet at about 8, and I learned to knit at about 10 or 11, and I was just so slow. You know, I was very slow. As you can see, I'm still pretty slow on English. Of course, this is even slower yet, because you have to carefully pull each stitch from behind, and this is going to get twisted on the knit side. But if you just turn and go across, twining across on the purl side, it untwists. So there's really no need to untwist it in between rows unless you just really want to. But then if you untwist it, it's going to twist on the purl side too, if you see what I mean. So anyway, Mama taught me how to throw, but I wasn't that as great at it, and it felt awkward. And plus I was a kid, you know. I just stuck with making my crocheted pot holders and scarves and whatnot. And I would every once in a while make a knit scarf or square or something, you know. But then I got pregnant with my first child. I was only 18, and I decided that I wanted to make a knit outfit for my baby, because all the really cute patterns that I could find that I really was drawn to turned out to be knit. So I will explain what I'm doing here in a little bit. I just wanted to go ahead and talk about the knitting style first. A lot of my groups on Ravelry have had really interesting discussions of people talking about whether they do English or Continental and all that and why. So I just thought that I would share that with y'all. And where was I? I decided I wanted to make this outfit. I'll insert a picture in the video here, maybe, or well, I'll just save that for another time. Of a knit outfit that I decided I wanted to make for my daughter. And by the time I had made this, you know, the hat, the sweater, the diaper cover, the booties, and all that, I felt a lot more comfortable with knitting and started, it kind of went about 50-50 knitting and crocheting, and just gradually over the years got to where I just love knit fabric. I still like to crochet sometimes, but I love knit fabric. And so I just gradually got to more and more to where I was knitting instead of crocheting. In the last few years, I've done very little crocheting. The last few years, the last 15 years, I have a crocheted tote bag somewhere that I knit. That was, I think, the last thing I crocheted until I did that pink washcloth last week. And there was a brand new podcaster that inspired me to get out my crochet hook and do that rag. I'll have to talk about her on another episode. But anyhow, so I spent probably the next 25 years or so just plugging along English style, and I just never really got very fast. But I had completely trashed my right shoulder in my younger years. I'd started at a young age messing with wild horses and whatnot, and I grew up kind of rough in some ways. Don't want to go into details, but in my world, you just didn't whine and complain. You sure didn't run to the doctor every time you got an owie and, Daddy, I hurt my shoulder. Well, put some ice on it and, you know, man up. Yes, I was a girl, but still. So apparently in my 30s, I had gotten extremely, ill and crippled up and extremely obese. I was probably pushing 350. And I tore my rotator cuff, and I went into the doctor, and he said, there is so much scar tissue and arthritis and bone spurs in there. He said, clearly you've torn this thing before. The joint is damaged. What in the world have you been doing, you know? Well, at that particular time, as embarrassing as it is to say, I had torn it just by lifting my obese body, because I was trying to use my arms to literally lift myself in and out of the bed and across the bed and stuff, because I was so weak I couldn't stand unassisted, and I didn't like to call for assistance, and you know, so but it had been torn and left to heal without surgery or any kind of doctor's care. At least two times before when I was younger. And so he said, what you really need is surgery. But he said, with your history of blood clots, I can't do a surgery on you unless it's life and death. And I had been told that before. When I ruptured discs in my back, they told me that. When they discovered a tumor in my chest, it's still there, as they will not do surgery on me unless it is an immediate life-threatening situation. Because I have had too many blood clots in my past. So he said, all I can do really is send you to physical therapy, because at that time I couldn't even raise my arm to shoulder height. And he said, you'll have to do the physical therapy while it heals to keep it from freezing up any more than it already is. And let me tell you, that was some painful physical therapy. But I had a wonderful physical therapist, and when the insurance ran out and I couldn't go to physical therapy anymore, she told me to get myself to the swimming pool and get into an aquasize class and move, get my arms under the water, get my shoulders under the water, and move my arms around as much as I could stand it. And that was the best thing anyone could have told me at that point in time, because at that point I still had not found the path to healing my body and was just trying to keep from becoming 100% disabled and crippled. I was taken off of all physical weight-bearing activity, including standing and walking and things like that there. When I was not in the water, I was supposed to be in a wheelchair. I say supposed to because I don't follow doctor's orders very well, never have. But it just reminded me when I got in that water, and it was hard at first to put on that swimming suit and go to a public pool and walk out there at 350 pounds, you know, nearly 350 pounds. And I'm sure that anyone else with the even modest weight issues or just body shaming issues or whatever, there's a lot of people that are embarrassed that think I can't go to the gym or I can't go to the pool because I can't let this body be seen in public. And you cannot let that stop you. I walked out there and I saw the looks and I heard the giggles, and then I got in the water and nobody could really see my body anymore, it was underwater, and I enjoyed the hell out of that class. And then after the class, I would look over there at those lap lanes and remember swimming laps. I taught swimming when I was young. I was an outstanding swimmer when I was young. And I would just look over there and wish that I could still swim those laps. And I thought, with limited mobility in my shoulder, yeah, right. And I also had no endurance. I mean, it got to where I could actually keep kind of moving throughout the entire class. Then I felt like I'd really made some progress, you know. And I finally decided one day after the class that I was going to go over there and just see if my body even could remember how to move through the water. And at first it was pretty rough and I barely made it one length, and that's only because I flipped over on my back. But little bit by little, I gained more endurance from being in the water. I was still off of all weight-bearing activity on land, but things didn't hurt as much in the water either because of the buoyancy of the water. And just, I can't even express how it feels to get in that water and be able to move without searing pain when you're used to searing pain from every movement. It was incredible. And so there was no way I was going to let the looks and the giggles stop me. And within months, I was swimming 10 laps, starting to lose weight. It was still, a 300 plus pound person going in there to swim laps and getting looks. But the funny thing is, once my body remembered, the muscle memory came back, like riding a bike. Your muscle memory is still in there and it will come back. And I would get out of the water and those same people that kind of rolled their eyes like, oh, she's going to take up a lane, you know, or the even sometimes those young people that giggled or snickered, I'd get out and they'd say, wow, lady, you can swim. And I just smile and say thank you and think, yes, I can. But the swimming until, I honestly am not sure that I would have made it to August of 2013 when I found whole food plant-based and juicing and all that and started healing my body. I'm not sure I would have even still been alive at that point if I hadn't gotten in the pool. Because when I tell you I had zero endurance, I mean, well, and just, not just, it wasn't just in, I, the reason I didn't have endurance is because I couldn't do anything. I wasn't allowed to, and the pain was horrific, and all, you know, all that happy crap. Again, if you want the full details of my whole journey, it's on the other channel. Natalie Michelle Mingus or Brand New Nat Show. The link is usually in the notes down below the down there. When I get to feeling frustrated because I can't get to the next level of activity or being able to do what I want to do, I remember that. I remember getting in the water and feeling triumphant because I could walk from one side of the pool to the other. And then I remember that first lap. And for me, every time I feed myself, every time I eat, I am either feeding the diseases that tried to kill me, or I am feeding health and living a long life free of pain, because I am free of pain now. I do pretty much whatever I want physically. I'm not really limited anymore. And I have full range of motion in that shoulder, just so you know. So, things like that, remembering those times helps keep me on track. And I am actually losing weight again for first time in like a year. I had stalled out. This last year was really challenging in many ways. I'm not going to go into that right now because this is getting longer than I intended it to be. But I am losing again. In the past month, I have lost 8 pounds. Yay me. Yay life. Yay whole food plant-based. And I want to wrap this up by putting some pictures of my mama. And Alternate, wonderful podcaster that I've mentioned before, asked on one of his videos, what was your inspiration to keep knitting? And for me, just the knitting itself is inspirational. I like I told him, I love knit fabric. I love watching it unfold out of the needles like I've been while I've been talking to you right here. Just watching it come out, grow. But even though I'm now knitting continental, and even though my hands are big and wide and blocky and mannish looking, and right now I have dirty fingernails, and my mom's hands and my grandma's hands were tiny, delicate little lady hands, and even though I'm using a different style of knitting than they used to use, I still can look at this work in my hands and just the way my hands move and the way my hands hold the yarn and the way they sit there sometimes when I stop knitting and I'm just quietly holding the knitting, I can see them there, my mom and my grandma. And there, it brings them near to me and keeps them a part of my life. That's my little sentimental moment there. And I'm gonna, like I said, I'm gonna put some pictures in here of my mama. And then I will, at the end, of course, put pictures of the horses and, I think I've got one, actually, that's grandkids. I've got some of the grandkids on the horses and me out in the round pen with the horse and all that before the end. But I did just real quickly want to do a little bit better job of describing what I was doing on this, because I didn't at all, did I? If anyone has actually hung out through this whole thing of just watching me knit a couple of rows of this this little thing, with the twined knitting, the sole trick of the whole thing is making sure that every stitch you take, that you bring the next stitch up from behind and then over the color before. The purple's got to come up behind and over, and then the pink's got to come up from behind and over, and onward and onward. And the same thing when you purl. It's just going to come up from behind over that color and stitch. Up from behind over and stitch. And like I said, it makes a really cool facing fabric, and I think it especially will be really nice for a washcloth, because you can't cover up the back, you know, the back of a washcloth. My color work is fairly neat on the other side too, but it doesn't do that. You know, that's just cool. So that's twined stitching. Like I said, there's videos that go into much better detail about how to make it than I did. But that's all I have for this week, and again, I probably went on longer than I should have about a number of things. I'm learning, and I do want to get a little more concise and a little less rambly as we go. But I also don't want to leave my personality at the door altogether, so, because what fun would that be? So hold on for the pictures of the love of my life, and then the horsey loves of my life, and happy knitting. Talk to you next time.